on.
I did turn it on, okay. Well, thank you very much, Jen. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay. There's still a few more seats down on the floor here. If any of you who are standing want to take them, the disadvantage is you can't slip out easily if I turn really boring. But there is more room down on the floor here. So what I'm going to talk about tonight is the subject matter that I covered in my most recent book, To End All Wars, which some of you are in course have read it. And it's about the First World War, which is an appropriate subject for us to be thinking about this year, of course, because it's the 100th anniversary of the war's beginning. So how should we look back on this war that, let me just change this so I can see it here, there we are. This war that in so many ways changed for the worse the world that we live in. I want to suggest some of the ways. The war has been a long time obsession of mine. It's something I've always been deeply interested in, almost for as long as I can remember. And the older I got and the more I read about it, the more I realized that there were good reasons for somebody to be obsessed by this period of history. Some 20 million military and civilian dead resulted from this war, which is at least six times as many people as were killed in any previous war in Europe. So you can imagine what a traumatic impact it had on the people who lived through it. There were an even larger number of soldiers left wounded. And the war affected Europe in a way that was also unfamiliar to that continent, in that it left behind a level of destruction not really known before. Because as the armies on each side retreated, they destroyed everything that could possibly be of use to the advancing enemy soldiers. That meant blowing up buildings, poisoning the wells, cutting down fruit trees, leaving scorched earth behind them. But you know, often when you write history, you are drawn to it by some sort of personal connection as well. And here's the one for me. An uncle of mine fought in the First World War. Here he is in the center of this picture with his fighter squadron of the Imperial Russian Air Force, the Tsar's Russia. And if you look closely, you can see a white cross hanging from around his neck. That is the cross of the Order of St. George, the highest decoration awarded by Imperial Russia. And it entitled the bearer to a personal audience with the Tsar at any time of day or night, a privilege that was not much use after 1917. Because, of course, the Russian Empire was swept away by that war, as were other empires as well. The German Empire, for instance. This is, on the left, Kaiser Wilhelm II of Germany, the Emperor of Germany, marching in a parade with his six sons. Just take a look at those hats. There is something about those hats and the hats worn in this picture by the Kaiser's wife, the Empress, and her daughter that, to me, telegraphs something about the imperial self-confidence of the Europe of 1914 that really would not be seen again. Now, the First World War, like almost all wars, including several that the United States has been involved in recently, was founded on several illusions. One was the illusion that victory was going to be quick and easy. These are students in Berlin marching off to enlist in August of 1914. The Kaiser told them very confidently, "You will be home before the leaves fall from the trees." Here they are, getting into a railroad carriage car to go to the front. And if you look closely at the side of the car, it says, "To Paris." Here are Frenchmen marching off to enlist August 1914 with equal enthusiasm. their railroad car to the front, and on the side it says to Berlin. Now, that was one of the illusions that I think allowed this war to start so easily, that victory would be quick and easy. Another illusion I can only describe as the belief that you would be shooting at the enemy, but the enemy would not be shooting at you. Now, how else can you explain the color of the uniforms with which several million French infantrymen marched off to battle in August 1914? These are not the dress uniforms. These are the combat uniforms. These bright red hats, bright blue coats, bright red pants. And they were not the only army that was very fond of red and blue. The Austro-Hungarian cavalry also wore bright red and blue uniforms, and they didn't abandon these until 2 years into the war. A third illusion, I think, was that the cavalry itself could play a role in the age of industrialized warfare. French cavalry in this picture, German cavalry here. These are the famous German Lancers. When Germany invaded France and Belgium in August 1914, they did so with 8 cavalry divisions, 40,000 men on horseback. Here's a British cavalryman practicing with a dummy for these glorious cavalry charges that everybody was convinced were going to be a major part of the war. Now, where did this illusion about the cavalry come from? I think it came from the fact that for thousands of years, the cavalry had been a very important part of warfare. Moreover, it had been a quick path to glory and promotion. Officers who were cavalry officers tended to get promoted more rapidly than other officers. And even though people should have known better by the age of industrialized warfare, they were still very reluctant to change their way of thinking. Armies change very slowly. I think also that all three illusions had their origins in what took place in the decades before World War I, namely colonial warfare. For British, French, and German officers who went into battle in 1914, their previous military experience for more than 30 years, actually more than 40 years, had been entirely in colonial warfare against very poorly armed Africans and Asians, putting down rebellions in their colonies or conquering new colonies. Just look at this panorama celebrating a British war in the Sudan in Africa in 1898. You can see all of the allusions here. First, the idea that cavalry could play a role. Winston Churchill, in fact, was a cavalry officer in that war. The illusion that the other side wouldn't be shooting at you, because in this war they mainly didn't. The Africans in this picture, you know, just armed with swords and spears. And the British have all the high technology, the repeating rifles, the artillery pieces you can see going off, the steamboats, the railroad train, and something you can't see in this picture, which is the machine gun. So this was the experience of quick and easy victory in colonial wars that officers brought into battle in 1914. And as soon as the First World War began, of course, the illusions ran up very quickly against a very harsh reality. Two of the greatest defensive weapons of all time, barbed wire, which brought an end to these glorious cavalry charges forever, and the machine gun. And as a result, the armies on both sides in Western Europe got bogged down on a line of deeply dug-in trenches that ran from the English Channel at the upper left down to the Swiss border, just beyond the lower right. And for more than 3 of the 4.5 years of war, that line moved very, very little. Just One example, in the year 1915, a year during which in this territory probably more than a million men were killed and wounded, the Allies made several large offensives, and in the entire year they gained exactly 8 square miles of ground. Here's what those trenches looked like from the air. The white you can see is chalk. There's a lot of chalk in the soil in that part of the world. And the zigzags in which the trenches are built, which I think you can see in this picture, is as protection against a shell landing, making a direct hit on a trench with the zigzag that protected people nearby from the blast extending in each direction. And instead of the glorious cavalry charges that the generals had long dreamed of, men found themselves fighting in absolutely devastated landscapes. This used to be a forest. On the area of the Western Front in France and Belgium, over the course of 4.5 years of war, more than 700 million artillery and mortar shells landed. And this is what they left the land looking like afterwards. And instead of the glorious cavalry charges, people found themselves living below ground in trenches, sharing space sometimes with corpses, sharing space with rats, very common throughout the trenches, and often fighting knee-deep in mud. They also found themselves up against some terrifying new weapons that they had not imagined before, like the flamethrower and poison gas, against which they improvised defenses, but the defenses often didn't do the job. These are British soldiers who were blinded by a gas attack, and they're keeping their position in line because they can't see by each man putting his hands on the shoulders of the guy in front of him. Most people who were wounded in this war, however, were wounded by bullets and shrapnel. And all you have to do is look at one picture and then magnify it in your mind by 21 million, which is the number of people who were wounded in the war, many of them horribly so. The effect of all this, the devastation, the horror, the stalemate in the fighting that went on for the better part of 4.5 years, I think deeply affected how people in Europe thought about themselves and about the world around them. Cartoons like this began appearing during the war. There was a new sort of cynical mood in the air about what the future of the human race might hold, very different from the mood of Victorian optimism, which those of you who've studied the 19th century will remember from then. Now, there was something else that was quite different about this war from the wars, for example, that the United States has fought recently. If you think about our wars in Vietnam, Iraq, Afghanistan, it's the poor who've done most of the dying, right? Very, very few children of members of Congress, senators, CEOs involved in these wars. In the First World War, it was the exact opposite on both sides. Casualties were disproportionately high among the elites. These, for example, are student cadets at Eton, Britain's most exclusive school, drilling in 1915. The following year, there were more than 30 Eton graduates who were killed in a single day, the first day of the Battle of the Somme. And the statistics are similar anywhere you look. Men who graduated from Oxford University in 1913, for example, 31% were killed. And comparable statistics on the French, in the French army, the German army, the Russian army. Why? Because it was traditional for young men from the elite to have careers as army officers. It was traditional that armies be officered by the upper classes. not only because this was something that had been the case for hundreds of years, but especially so in the decades before the First World War, when European armies were very often used as strikebreakers, suppressing labor rebellions of one sort or another. And you couldn't possibly dare to have troops suppressing a strike commanded by somebody from the working class because, heaven forbid, he might sympathize with the workers. So the result was that on all sides, like these French cavalry officers, the officer corps of the armies involved tended to come from the upper classes. And many people in these elites wanted military careers for their children. For example, Rudyard Kipling, who was then probably Britain's most famous and beloved writer, long encouraged a love of all things military in his young son, John, who's probably about 4 years old in this picture. And John had trouble getting into the military because he'd inherited his father's bad eyesight. You know how Kipling has very thick eyeglasses in any pictures you see of him. But his father pulled strings. Finally, John Kipling was commissioned a second lieutenant. And in 1915, he went into action at the Battle of Loos and was never seen again. One more example from Britain about the toll taken among the elites. This building is Hatfield House, one of the great old British country homes. Queen Elizabeth I actually spent part of her childhood on this estate, and it was long the seat of the Cecil family. The patriarch of that family, Lord Salisbury, was Prime Minister of Britain for many years at the turn of the century. He had 10 grandsons. 5 of them were killed in the war. Here's one, George Cecil, killed at the age of 18, just a few weeks into the war. Prime Minister Herbert Asquith of Britain lost a son. So did his counterpart, Chancellor Theobald von Bethmann-Hollweg of Germany. The man in the middle in this picture, General Sir Herbert Lawrence, was chief of staff of the British Army on the Western Front. He lost two sons. His counterpart in the French Army, General Noel de Castelnau, lost 3 sons. So in order to understand this war, we have to understand the power that those illusions had over men like this, who were literally willing to send their own sons into battle day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, for 4.5 years. Now, there was something else that made this war quite different from preceding wars, which was the extent to which it involved the civilian populations of the countries involved. On both sides, there was tremendous amount of spy mania. People were being asked to look for spies, to search out traitors, because when things go wrong, when victory isn't quick, when hundreds of thousands, millions of people are killed, somebody has to be blamed. And there's always a search for scapegoats of one sort or another. This was reflected in various ways. In Germany, there were the beginnings of accusations directed against Jews, which of course grew much stronger as the years passed. In the United States and Britain, there was outrage directed at any kind of business with a German name. This is a shop being destroyed by an angry crowd in London. The same thing happened again and again in the United States. All over the place. Didn't matter if the owner of the business, you know, might be a third or fourth generation Briton or American, a German name was enough. Another way in which the war affected the civilian population was that it generated millions of refugees. The ones in this picture happened to be Belgian, but there were actually a much larger number of refugees on the other side of Europe, and in the Middle East who were fleeing their homes. One of the things they were fleeing was the likelihood of being conscripted as forced laborers to work in war industries by the power, in this case Germany, that occupied their country. And this brought about the beginnings of a kind of totalitarian control over civilian populations that we would see much more of in Europe as the 20th century went on. For example, to prevent people in occupied Belgium from fleeing across the border into Holland, which was neutral, the Germans built an electrified fence that ran the entire length of the border. It was electrified at 2,000 volts, and more than 300 people died trying to cross it. It was the first electrified border fence in Europe, but unfortunately not the last. Now, the very madness of this war, the vast destructiveness, the horror of the slaughter, has long made me particularly respect the people who at the time saw it as madness and spoke out against it. There were such war resistors in all countries. In the United States, for instance, the great labor leader Eugene V. Debs spoke out very strongly against the war when the United States entered it in 1917. Because of this, he was sent to prison, and he was still in prison in November 1920 when he received nearly 1 million votes for president on the Socialist Party ticket. The pioneer social worker, Jane Addams, another American, helped organize a conference in neutral Holland in the middle of the war where she tried to bring together women from both sides and from neutral countries as well. More than 500 Americans, like the two in this picture at Fort Riley, Kansas, refused the draft and were locked up as a result. In Germany, the well-known radical Rosa Luxemburg was sent to prison for her opposition to the war, as were many other people. In France, the socialist leader Jean Jaurès, you can see him here with the white beard sticking out, spoke out very strongly against the war that he saw coming in the months and weeks before the war. A week before the war began, he rushed to an emergency conference of the leaders of Europe's left-wing parties in Brussels, and before an enormous crowd in a big city plaza there, he stood with his arm around the leaders of the German leader of the German Social Democratic Party and said, "We will never make war on each other." Because of this, 3 days later, when he returned to France, he was assassinated. 3 days after that, the war began. His assassin, incidentally, was kept in prison during the war, not put on trial until the war ended, and then was found innocent because his was judged to be a patriotic crime of passion. The war that brave people like this were up against had another distinguishing characteristic. It was the first big propaganda war. Again, the civilian population being whipped up by their governments. This is a US Army recruiting poster. You can see the image it's portraying of the Germans here. Here's a German poster with God for King and Fatherland. God was, of course, invoked by both sides. Here's a poster, if you can believe it, trying to get Australians alarmed about the possibility of a German invasion of Australia, which would have been pretty difficult to carry off. And this propaganda usually had a nasty edge to it. If you didn't volunteer, you were letting down the women. You were guilty or cowardly. And worst of all, you were effeminate. That was the worst thing that could be said of someone. Now, as I mentioned, there were war resistors in all the principal warring countries. But for various reasons, there were more of them in Great Britain than anywhere else. More than 20,000 young British men of military age refused conscription into their armed forces. Many of them also, as a matter of principle, refused the alternative service that was offered for conscientious objectors, because that could mean working in a war industry or driving an ambulance at the front. And as a result, more than 6,000 of them went to prison. Prisons like this one at Wandsworth, southwest London. That wire netting you can see stretched across the opening there is to prevent people from committing suicide by jumping over the edge. This was the largest number of people up to that point in time who had ever been imprisoned for political reasons in a Western democracy. And they were a remarkable group of people. Here's one of them, a man named Fenner Brockway, who had been a newspaper editor before the war. He continued to work as a newspaper editor in prison, editing a clandestine newspaper for his fellow resistors, published on toilet paper. It lasted for a year before the authorities discovered it and shut it down and put him in solitary confinement for the remainder of the war. It was not just people in Britain of military age who suffered for speaking out about their beliefs. The country's most prominent philosopher, Bertrand Russell, was a very strong opponent of the war. And I came to respect Russell very much in writing about this period because he was so honest at describing the contradictions that he felt. Let me just read you a couple of things that he wrote at the time. He described himself very poignantly at the beginning of the war as feeling tortured by patriotism. "I desired the defeat of Germany as ardently as any retired colonel. Love of England is very nearly the strongest emotion I possess, and in appearing to set it aside at such a moment, I was making a very difficult renunciation." And then he went on to speak at another point about how hard it was to resist being swept away when the whole nation is in a state of violent collective excitement. As much effort was required to avoid sharing this excitement as would have been needed to stand out against the extreme of hunger or sexual passion. And there was the same feeling of going against instinct. He got 6 months in prison for these sentiments. Someone else who spent 6 months in prison, in his case at hard labor, was Britain's leading investigative journalist, Edmund Dean Morrell. If any of you have read my book, King Leopold's Ghost, you'll remember him as the hero of that story. His time in prison broke his health, and he died of a heart attack at the age of 51 a few years later. Now, those of you here are mostly too young to remember the period of the Vietnam War in the United States, when there was fiercely divided opinion in this country about whether or not we should be in Vietnam. But one thing that we experienced then, divisions within families, happened very often in Britain during the First World War as well. For example, one outspoken opponent of the war was a woman named Charlotte Despard, who was a staunch radical on all the major issues of the day. She favored independence for India, independence for Ireland. She'd been to jail 4 times in the battle for women's suffrage. For much of the war, she traveled up and down England speaking to rallies, some of which were broken up by rock-throwing mobs. Sometimes they were shut down by the police. Meanwhile, her brother, Sir John French, was commander-in-chief on the Western Front. As soon as I discovered this pair, I thought, wow, they're going to be interesting to write about. And indeed they were. They were very fond of each other. They stayed in touch during the war. They stopped speaking to each other only when, in 1918, near the end of the war, the British government faced a nationalist rebellion in Ireland, and they felt they needed a military man with a strong hand to suppress these rebels. They sent him to Ireland to be viceroy. She went to Ireland to work for the IRA, who were the people rebelling. They stopped speaking at that point. Another outspoken British opponent of the war was a woman named Emily Hobhouse, who did something quite remarkable. In 1916, she traveled from England to France, France to Switzerland, which was neutral, from Switzerland into Germany, and in Germany she went to Berlin, where she went to call on the German foreign minister, whom she had known before the war. And this is a trip unauthorized by anybody. She began talking about peace terms. If we did this, might you do that? And how about a deal along these principles? She came away thinking, incorrectly, I think, that she had the outlines of a possible peace agreement that Germany might agree to, went back to Switzerland, to France, to England, tried and failed to see people high in the British government who wrote her off as a complete crackpot. But I think she deserves a place in history, because in this war that killed so many millions of people, she is the only human being who traveled from one side to the other in search of peace while the war was going on. Here's my favorite British war resister of all, a man named John S. Clark. He was born into a circus family in Scotland. And at the age of 17, he went into the ring as the youngest lion tamer in Great Britain. Then he got involved in radical politics, became a strong opponent of the war. In 1915, a year into the war, he was tipped off by a friendly policeman that he was about to be arrested. He went underground, stayed underground for the remainder of the war, editing and writing for an underground newspaper that the government was trying to shut down, but they couldn't succeed in doing so because they never found where it was published. After the war, he surfaced, eventually became briefly a Labour Party Member of Parliament, then spent the last decade of his life on the Glasgow City Council. And whenever a circus came to town, he would go back into the ring, and at that point, he was the oldest lion tamer in Great Britain. This is why I enjoy writing history, because you know, if you invented somebody like this for a novel, people would tell you it's implausible. There couldn't be such a person. But there was, and here's his picture. The war that people like this resisted caused absolutely unprecedented suffering, and it spread across the world. From the very beginning, of course, there was an immense amount of fighting on the Eastern Front, in Russia and what today is Poland, Ukraine, Belarus, and other nations in that part of the world. There was warfare at sea. This is a British ship getting torpedoed in the Mediterranean. More than 700 German sailors lost their lives when this warship was sunk in 1915. The war spread to Africa, where each side lusted after the other side's colonies and tried to conquer them. More than, because so much of the terrain in Africa was rugged and there were few roads that could carry vehicles, more than 2 million Africans were conscripted as porters by the rival armies. And some 400,000 of them died, which was were worked to death. This is a higher death rate than there was on the Western Front. The war spread to the Middle East. This is an Australian camp at the foot of the pyramids. And it encompassed the world in a different way as well, in that the death toll was so huge that Britain and France imported huge numbers of troops from their colonies to fight in Europe and on the other fronts. These are Algerian soldiers in France. Soldiers also came from British India, from the West Indies, from Southern and Central Africa, from all over. And still, the killing went on and on. There were so many deaths that by the end, the British were drafting 17-year-olds, and the Germans were putting into uniform men still younger. Still, the carnage continued, and by the end, the war left more than 9 million soldiers dead, and depending on how you count them or really estimate them, somewhere between 9 and 12 million civilian dead. And there were vast other consequences of the war as well, some of which I'm sure you know about, set in motion by the man on the far right in this picture, shown with his German World War I Army unit, who, of course, 20 years later, led the world into an even more destructive world war and the Holocaust to boot. It's really impossible, I think, to imagine the Second World War without the bitterness and resentment that was left by the first. Something else that the war ignited was the Russian Revolution. I think that Russia was due for an upheaval in any case. I don't think it could have lasted that far into the 20th century as a totally absolute monarchy. But I think without the enormous death toll and terrible stress brought about by the war, the most extreme and intolerant group of revolutionaries would not have come to power in Russia, with terrible consequences for that country, which left millions of Soviets locked up in prison camps like this, often for decades. So my hope is that in this centenary year, when we look back at the First World War, we'll remember not just the politicians and not just the generals, although those are the people who usually get written about, but also those who tried to stop the war, even though they were not successful. I still think we can draw inspiration from them. Now I'm going to end by showing you some documentary film footage from the First World War, and while it's showing, play you some music. It's a song some of you may know by the Scottish songwriter Eric Bogle, who says it was inspired by a visit he made to one of these vast military graveyards which spread across the area of the old Western Front in France and Belgium, millions of graves. And he was going through one, he looked down and saw the name of an Irish soldier, McBride, on a tombstone, and the song is addressed to him. So listen to the words, and here's the music.
Well, how do you do, young Willie McBride? Do you mind if I sit here down by your graveside and rest for a while near the warm summer sun? I've been walking all day and I'm nearly done. I see by your gravestone you were only 19 when you joined the great fallen in 1916. I hope you died well and I hope you died clean. Or young Willie McBride, was it slow and unseen? Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife slowly? Did they sound the death march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes play the flowers of the forest? Sweetheart behind, in some faithful heart is your memory enshrined. Although you died back in 1916, in that faithful heart are you forever 19. But are you a stranger without even a name, enclosed then forever behind a glass frame, in an old photograph, torn, battered, and stained, and faded alone in a brown leather frame? Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife lowly? Did they sound the dead march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes play the flowers of the forest? The sun, now it shines on the green fields of France. There's a warm summer breeze makes the red poppies dance. And look how the sun shines from under the clouds. There's no gas, no barbed wire, there's no gun firing now. But here in this graveyard, it's still no man's land. The countless white crosses stand mute in the sand. To man's blind indifference to his fellow man, to a whole generation that were butchered and damned. Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife slowly? Did they sound the death march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes play the flowers of the forest? I am Willie McBride. I can't help wonder why. Do those that lie here know why did they die? And did they believe when they answered the call? Did they really believe that this war would end war? For the sorrow, the suffering, the glory, the pain, killing and dying was all done in vain. For young Willie McBride, it all happened again, and again and again and again and again. Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife slowly? Did they sound the death march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes play the flowers over the forest? Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the fife slowly? Did they sound the death march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last chorus? Did the pipes play the flowers of the forest?
So that's it. If you've got comments or questions, I would be glad to hear them. Yeah.
Would you describe yourself as a pacifist for all wars or just this?
Would I describe myself as a pacifist? Good question. I would describe myself as an 80 or 90% pacifist. I think at least 80 or 90% of wars, in retrospect, looked at with a historian's eye many years later, appear to me to be not worth fighting. I do think there are a small number of wars that I think probably were worth fighting in, but it's a pretty small number compared to the whole shebang. That's just my opinion. Others may feel differently. Yeah.
Curious about Marshal Pétain. Checkered history, but what's your take on him during the war?
Question was about Marshal Pétain, who was the supreme commander on the French side towards the end of the war, but who later fell into terrible disgrace because he was really a collaborator with Hitler. In fact, he ended his life in sort of penal exile on an island off the coast of France. During the First World War, he was the person who really led the French army in recovering from a spate of mutinies that occurred in early 1917. He actually set his officers to doing historical research about what had caused mutinies in armies in the past and what had been done to suppress them. And they discovered certain simple things, like if you improved the soldiers' diet, if you did not deny them leave to go home that had been promised to them, if you made it easier for them to get mail from home, these things improved their morale and they would keep on fighting. On the other hand, I think the French mutineers were right in 1917, and I wish more people had mutinied and the war had come to an end sooner as a result. But certainly as a general at that time, or a field marshal, I guess he was, I think he was certainly more effective than his predecessors. Yeah. Actually, the figure for shells that landed during the war is over 700 million. Nobody knows how many of them are unexploded, what percentage of them were duds. That is a high explosive artillery shell that, when it landed, went deep into the mud and didn't explode and stay there. Some people think 10%, some people think 20% of the shells were duds. And they have been going off ever since 1918. People are killed in accidents every year because a farmer's plow or harrow hits one of these shells and sets it off. And actually, you can sometimes see on tractors in this region that they will have, in regions where the war shelling was particularly heavy, today they will have a sheet of armor plate underneath the seat. So in case the tractor sets off one of these shells, the person driving it will be hopefully saved from injury. But both the French and Belgian governments employ teams of roving people who very gingerly pick up these shells when a farmer calls them and says, my tractor just hit something in the field. And then they are very carefully trucked away, defused, taken to a remote spot off the French coast where every couple of weeks they blow them all up. But people are killed, as I say, every year and probably will continue to be, unfortunately. This is kind of a symbol to me of the legacy that the war left. Yeah. The question was, how did I pick the characters through whom I told this story? I think some of you have read To End All Wars, but not all of you. For those who haven't read it, I should just explain that when I write a book of history, I like to try to bring a period alive by picking 10, 12, 15 people whose lives intersect in one way or another. They're friends, enemies, lovers, connected with each other somehow or other, and then tell the story through them. I feel that for this particular book, I was on a character hunt for years before figuring out who would the final set of people in the cast of characters be. Because unlike being a novelist or filmmaker, when you make up a cast of characters, you can invent people. But when you're writing a history book, they have to be real people. And if you quote them as saying something, they have to have actually said it. So part of what determines it is that, you know, what sorts of people have left written records behind them? Whose letters can I find? Whose diary can I find? Who was prominent enough so that there are a lot of other people describing what this person looked like or did on a particular occasion? You mentioned the business of class. One of the problems you find in writing history is that there's a much greater written trail from educated people, college graduates and so on. These tend to be the folks who, you know, write memoirs and keep diaries and that sort of thing. So my cast of characters in this book leans perhaps disproportionately toward those. I felt I was lucky to be able to get as many working class and lower middle class characters as I did have, because there usually isn't good material on them. In the case of one group of characters, the Wheeldon family, who were the subject of a government witch hunt during the war and were framed as a trial. This was a woman who, with her three daughters and son-in-law, were sheltering draft evaders in their house, and the government framed totally spurious charges against them, put them in jail. I got access to their written records because the British government was monitoring all their mail, and once it set them sent them to prison, it confiscated all the letters in their house. So happily, I can now read those letters in the British National Archive. But it's rare that you get that kind of documentary material from a family that isn't in the elite. A couple of the other characters in the book, Albert Rochester and Keir Hardie, were very much people from the working class, but they were both labor union journalists, so they wrote a lot for their union newspapers, memoirs, articles, and so forth as well. But there is very much a tendency that history skews towards writing about the educated, the elite, rather than such folks. And you have to work hard to counteract that. Yeah. Well, you know, it's a big problem because the traditional things that we means through which we remember wars, and you've all been exposed to these things, I think, are monuments, parades on Memorial Day, 4th of July, Veterans Day, whatever, military parades, and war museums, which every country has and which are usually museums of, you know, various pieces of technology, each of which is better than the last at killing people. These are the sort of public ways we usually have of remembering wars. There are very, very, very few museums anywhere that celebrate great dissenters. In Britain, there's a particularly vigorous debate about this because there are a lot of people who feel that this year, the centenary year, it's the dissenters who should be celebrated. And they were so vocal that some months ago, the Minister of Education actually gave a speech where he said, no, this war was necessary, and it's, you know, the people we should be celebrating are those brave young lads who died for their country. This, of course, produced an even greater outpouring and response from the dissenters. And it produced a couple of speaking invitations for me to go to England, where I'm going next week, so I can tell you a little bit more about it after I come back. There are local, what they call people's history groups in various British cities who are doing their best to commemorate some of these people. And one of the places I'm going to is the town of Derby, where Alice Wheeldon, this woman I mentioned, who was sent to prison, came from. And her great-granddaughter will be there, and with other citizens of that town, has succeeded in getting the town to put a marker on their great-grandmother's house, and they're trying to get the government to retroactively find her innocent from her sham conviction in 1917. And there are similar movements like this in other parts of the country. I've actually been pleased to find that there are as many people talking about or celebrating the dissenters this year. They're more than I would have expected. Maybe because 100 years have passed, it's sort of safe to look at some of these folks. Yeah. It is true. They're discovering them all the time because there are archaeological teams from the countries involved who are digging in various fields. I don't know the figures for, you know, how many new bodies have been discovered when, since when. One of the problems in the Western Front, which is what we usually hear about, France and Belgium, is that that area of the world has been fought over so much that when you discover a body, sometimes it's a little unclear whether it was from the First World War or the Second World War or the Franco-Prussian War or even the Napoleonic War. And these teams that dispose of the unexploded shells have become quite expert at distinguishing between the ordnance from these different wars and are quite excited when they find something from the Franco-Prussian War of 1870 because that's pretty rare. But there was one set of some 250 British and Australian bodies that were found in a mass grave in a field in France in 2009. And they know exactly what battle they came from. It was in late July 1916. It's sort of a poignant story. There was a group of primarily Australian soldiers who were ordered to make an attack. And the general, brigadier general immediately commanding them, an Australian guy, knew this attack was senseless because they were being asked to advance against a German machine gun that was fortified in a concrete bunker that had not been knocked out by artillery. And he did something very rare, which was that he protested to the commander in chief, which you usually don't do in warfare. And the commander-in-chief, General Haig of Britain, told him to go ahead and attack. Some 1,000 soldiers were killed. The general was seen walking among the survivors the next day, weeping uncontrollably. 15 years later, in Australia, he committed suicide. And I think somebody like that should be counted as a casualty of this war as well. Yeah.
So David Lloyd George and Woodrow Wilson.
Why wasn't it the war to end all wars? I think very simply because most wars cause more problems than they solve. And never was there a war that was more true of than this one. And just to briefly review how it ended, in basically, the German generals knew they had lost in late 1918. So, and Germany had basically been, in effect, a military dictatorship for the last 2 years of the war. They very cleverly maneuvered a civilian government into power so that government would take the blame when the war was lost. And then they signed what was called an armistice, November 11th, 1918. And it was called an armistice, but it really was a German surrender. The German people didn't realize this right away because they had been fed a diet of triumphal propaganda right up to the very end. You know, our armies are about to win. You know, our brave boys have just had a temporary setback. But, and in fact, some 6 months earlier, the Germans almost had succeeded in capturing Paris. Then gradually it sunk in over the next couple of months that they had lost the war, that Germany's territory was shrunken by about 10%, pieces of it parceled out to other countries, that Allied troops were occupying part of Germany, and that was very fertile ground for Hitler to spread the myth that we were about to win this war until we were stabbed in the back by pacifists, communists, and Jews. And it was on that that Hitler rose to power. So that was a direct consequence of this war, and I think led, as I mentioned, directly to the Second World War. Yeah. Am I working on a book now? Yes, I'm writing a book about another war, the Spanish Civil War of 1936 to 39, which some of you may know something about, which was unusual because it was, it's the only civil war where nearly 3,000 Americans volunteered to fight. And I'm writing about the Americans who volunteered to fight in the Spanish Civil War and American journalists who covered the war and various other Americans who were connected to it. And I hope I'm about 2 or 3 months away from finishing the book, but I've been saying that for about 6 months, so that's not a good sign. Some of you have probably had that experience with term papers and other things.
Thank you very much for coming. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
And if you're interested in having your book signed, Adam Hoekstra will be here in the front of the room to do that, or to buy a book if you're interested in buying a book.